Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at practice problems for chirality and stereochemistry. To solve these problems, we're going to use the tutorials, tricks, and shortcuts that I teach in the chirality series, which you can find on my website along with the stereochemistry practice quiz, leiaforsci.com/chirality. Let's start with some warm-up problems, where we want to draw the enantiomer of a given chiral molecule. In this case, we have a 4-carbon chain with a chlorine on carbon 2 coming forward. That tells us the chiral carbon is carbon number 2. We have two easy ways to draw the enantiomer, and while it doesn't matter which one you use, sometimes one will make more sense than the other. We can either use the swap method to simply swap the chiral center, or we can draw the mirror image by dropping a mirrored plane next to the molecule and drawing the other one in reverse. Let's start with a swap. To do that, I copy the carbon skeleton exactly as I see it and simply swap two of the groups on the chiral carbon. In this case, I'll be swapping chlorine, which is coming forward, with the invisible hydrogen, which is going back. I don't have to show the invisible hydrogen, I just have to recognize that that's where I'm creating the swap. And so, when I draw the enantiomer, I'll put chlorine on dashes to show that it's going into the page, allowing us to understand that hydrogen, even though invisible, is now coming forward out of the page. The other option is the mirror image, and this is where we draw exactly what we see, but right becomes left and left becomes right. That means the carbon skeleton looks like this, but chlorine is still coming up and out of the page. This looks tricky. The instinct for many students is to draw the mirror image, but to put this in the back, to put it on dashes rather than on a wedge, but you want to be very careful. Drawing the mirror image is like doing, number one, creating a swap, but we're not swapping this group. That still comes forward in the mirror. We're just swapping whatever's facing the mirror and whatever is away. So one other way to think about it is that we really did option number one, but what we swapped were the ethyl and the methyl group, so that the ethyl on the right in the plane of the page is now on the left in the plane of the page, and methyl, which was on the left, is now on the right. Let's prove that we did the swap correctly by finding R and S for each stereo center. When assigning priorities, we take the periodic table into consideration. Specifically, these 10 atoms that I highly, highly recommend you memorize to help you with so many different topics. On this molecule, we're comparing chlorine to carbon to hydrogen. Chlorine is going to be your highest priority. Hydrogen would be your lowest priority. And with carbon, we look at what else is attached. On the ethyl group, we have a CH2 bound to a CH3. On the methyl group, we have a carbon bound to 3 hydrogen atoms. When we compare the carbon to the carbon and they cancel out, we move on to the next highest priority, which on the ethyl is another carbon, and the methyl is any one of the hydrogen atoms. This makes the ethyl outrank the methyl, or you can simply remember the trick that a methyl group is always going to be your lowest priority after a hydrogen atom. Chlorine is priority number 1, ethyl is number 2, methyl 3, and hydrogen in the back is number 4. We cancel out number 4, trace a path from 1 to 2 to 3, giving us a starting molecule with the R configuration. Let's look at the mirror image, chlorine 1, ethyl 2, methyl 3. Hydrogen is number 4, but it's going into the back, so we don't really care. We can just put dashes 4 to show that we know it's there. We're going to account for it by crossing it out, but that's it. We don't actually have to show the hydrogen. And then trace a path from 1 to 2 to 3, giving us the S configuration. Let's do the same thing for the molecule below. Chlorine is still 1, ethyl 2, methyl 3. Hydrogen is now a little bit of a problem because it's number 4, but it's not in the back. Same thing though, cancel out number 4, trace the path from 1 to 2 to 3, but when your arc goes clockwise and number 4 is in the front, we simply switch the direction to counterclockwise, giving us the S configuration. If the starting molecule is R, the enantiomer should be S, and we know we did it correctly. Same thing for the next problem. Draw the enantiomer of this chiral molecule. Go ahead, give it a try. Let's see what you got. For a molecule like this with a ring, I find the easiest thing to simply drop a mirror next to the molecule and draw the same thing in reverse. So I'll draw everything I see, but whatever's facing the mirror has to be facing the mirror from the other side, and that means bromine up and towards the right is still going to be up, but now it's towards the left because it's still facing the mirror. OH down, but towards the right, is now going to be OH down towards the left, once again, facing the mirror. For more practice, try to assign R and S for the starting molecule and the enantiomer to prove you did it correctly. Once again, we want to draw the enantiomer, this time looking at a Fischer projection. If you haven't studied Fischers, ignore this and jump to the next problem. Otherwise, take a look and think about what you want to do. With Fischer projections, it's just as easy to draw a mirror or to do a swap. But remember, if you're doing a swap, we have two chiral centers, so we have to make sure to swap both, giving us the enantiomer rather than a diastereomer. Let's start with a mirror image. Just draw a mirror down the center. Copy out the skeleton, adding all the achiral substituents. Then we'll add the chiral substituents, such that anything facing the mirror is still facing the mirror in the opposite direction, giving me two OH groups on the left and two hydrogens on the right. If you choose to do this with the swap method instead, you can swap any substituents. Most students like to swap what's right and left, and wait a minute, doesn't that give you the same exact thing? What do you think? Ready to go to more advanced problems? First, give this video a thumbs up, and if you haven't already, subscribe to my channel, and then, let's see if we can assign R and S to a few more chiral centers. For this molecule, first we want to identify the chiral centers. How many do you see here? Pay very, very close attention, because if you said two, the answer is just one. Look at it. This appears to be a chiral center, and indeed it is. In order for a carbon to be chiral, it has to have four unique substituents. This carbon right here has a methyl group, has an NH2, and an isopropyl group. That's just three, but don't forget we have an invisible hydrogen atom coming out of the page, giving us substituent number four. This carbon is pretending to be chiral, and I'm including this here because professors love to put this on exams and students always fall for it, but you're not going to. Even though the methyl group is on a wedge, it's pretending to be three-dimensional. It's pretending to be chiral. It's not. What do we have on this carbon? Let's first fill in the invisible hydrogen going into the page towards the back and then count our substituents. We have a hydrogen into the page. That's one. This entire group, we're not even going to try to name it. Just recognize it's complicated, but it's unique. That's number two. And then we have a methyl, and we have a methyl. Just because they're drawn differently doesn't make them different. Having two CH3 groups on the same carbon makes this an achiral carbon, and therefore gives us just one chiral center on the molecule. Now that we have our chiral center, let's find its designation. What do we have? We're comparing nitrogen to hydrogen to two carbon atoms. A quick peek at the periodic table tells us nitrogen is highest priority. Hydrogen, you don't even need the table, just recognize it's lowest priority, giving us a number four for hydrogen, a number one for nitrogen. And then isopropyl versus methyl. Methyl is CH. Isopropyl is C bound to two C's, making it higher priority. Isopropyl is two. Methyl is three. Carbon number four is not going towards the back, so we're going to reverse what we get. Cross out number four, trace a path from one to two to three, which appears to go clockwise, but reverse it to go counterclockwise because hydrogen coming forward requires us to reverse what we found, and that gives us the S configuration. Let's try another. In this case, we have a ring, but that doesn't make it more difficult. A lot of students instantly freeze up when there's a ring, but if you can treat it the same way as a linear molecule, it'll be much easier. First thing we do is identify the chiral centers, and in this case we have two. How do I know there are two? Let's not forget our invisible hydrogen atoms. On the upper right, we have a hydrogen coming forward out of the page. And on the bottom of the ring, we have it going down and into the page. Let's peek at the periodic table, starting with the lower chiral center. We're comparing sulfur to hydrogen to a carbon that's a CH2 in the ring and a carbon that's a CH2 in the ring. That doesn't help us. This is where you remember the trick. If you can trace a boring path on a chain or around a ring, the first one to hit the substituent is higher priority. We have a shorter path in the counterclockwise direction, making that the higher priority than this one, which is a much longer path to the first substituent. What does that tell us? Well, sulfur is always going to be higher than carbon. Hydrogen is always number 4. The shorter path to the substituent will be priority number 2. The longer path to the substituent will be priority number 3. Number 4 is conveniently in the back, so cross it out. Trace the path from 1 to 2 to 3, which gives us the S configuration. Let's do the same thing for the upper chiral center, but here it gets a little tricky. We automatically know that hydrogen is number 4, but the remainder of the groups are comparing carbon, carbon in the ring, carbon in the ring. This is where we look at the next atom and the next atom. The substituent is a tert-butyl. It's a carbon bound to 3 other carbons, making it the highest priority. Even though sulfur as a substituent is higher in priority than anything on the tert-butyl, the fact is, carbon hits the 3 methyl groups faster than this carbon hits the sulfur because this carbon hits a carbon before it hits sulfur. However, comparing the two directions around the ring, it's a shorter path to the sulfur, making this number 2, and a longer path to the sulfur, making this number 3, and now we're good to go. Since number 4 is in the front, we're going to reverse our configuration. So first, cross out number 4, trace the path from 1 to 2 to 3, reverse the path because number 4 is in the front, and that gives us the S configuration. What do you think? Do you feel warmed up for stereochemistry, ready to tackle even more practice? If so, make sure you visit my website for the Chirality and Stereochemistry tutorial series, practice quiz, and cheat sheet. Go to layerforsci.com/chirality.